Hey there, boys and girls, and welcome to another episode of Luthorville. In this one, I'll be going over all the technical specifications of my tiny house project. You know, of all the dreams that I've accomplished in my life, the one that I did not make come true was becoming an astronaut. So, I did the next best thing. I purchased a landscape in the Old West, as desolate as the moon, and built my very own spaceship. Now, you can't survive in an environment like this if you have not planned your lunar base properly. You know, living out here, that's a lot like living on the planet Whitefall in the Firefly TV show. In a lot of ways, this is an anachronistic endeavor, right? I mean, I'm a cowboy colonizing Mars. I'm an astronaut in the Old West. I am a pioneer settler in the verse.
Luthorville is an educational series inspiring kids and adults to become excited about innovations in science and technology by documenting the design and construction of a Mojave Desert homestead called Galatea Meridian. Witness the crazy story of how Eric Muss-Barnes, an unemployed computer geek and struggling novelist, risks homelessness by spending most of his life savings to build an off-grid dream house in the middle of nowhere. Having purchased vast acres of the Old West, can Eric find a stable job and create his home before his money runs out? Take a journey where fortitude and a pioneering spirit continue to forge the American dream on the romantic landscape of the American frontier.
So the way that this video will be constructed is I'll start on the outside of the tiny house and then we'll move to the inside. So starting on the outside, the exterior of the tiny house, let's start with the foundation, which is the trailer itself. Now, most tiny houses are not houses at all. They are considered recreational vehicles by the Department of Motor Vehicles in most states. Most of the trailers used for tiny houses are rated to hold around 15,000 pounds. They attach to a trailer hitch, which makes the trailer prone to sway, and they only have a few inches of ground clearance. Now, I decided to get a commercial gooseneck trailer, specifically a 25-foot 22GN HD from Big Tex, which solves all of those problems. This trailer can carry 25,000 pounds. The gooseneck attachment greatly reduces the chances of trailer sway, and I have a far higher ground clearance running down the length of the trailer. However, if you're going to get a trailer that's this big, depending on what state you live in, you might need a commercial driver's license in order to use a trailer of this size. I happen to have a commercial driver's license, so that's not an issue for me. And by extending the bedroom area over the hitch, I have around 323 square feet of living space, but that includes the porch area. So in reality, it's a little bit smaller than that. The high side of the structure is 13 feet, and the top of the solar panels is 13 feet 2 inches. So I am well below the legal limit of 13 feet 6 inches. This particular trailer also came with two ramps on the back for loading equipment, and I designed the house to remove one ramp and turn this area into a storage shed. And this allowed me to use the other half of the trailer as a toy hauler and transport my motorcycle on the porch. So once the original wood was removed, the first layer became corrugated flashing, and then the wood and insulation went on top of that. And removing the original wood and using the flashing was done to protect the insulation and the foundation of wood from water damage and road debris. So, you're going to want to have a trailer that can be registered with the DMV as a recreational vehicle. By officially and legally building my tiny house as a RVIA compliant recreational vehicle, I could make sure my tiny house was built in accordance with all state and federal safety regulations for this type of vehicle. And this also assures you can take your tiny house into state parks and many RV parks around the country. Now, most RV parks are privately owned, and for insurance purposes and safety and liability reasons, they will only allow certified vehicles onto their property. Now, you will need to get your tiny house inspected before your state issues your trailer a license, and RVIA certification assures inspectors your tiny house is built to code. And there are many tiny house builders who are not RVIA certified, and working with them can cause potential problems down the line when you try to get a license plate for your trailer. So, make sure the structure you create meets up to the official certifications and building codes. Most traditional houses are built using nails, right? You nail the wood together. That's not such a good idea when you're building a tiny house, something that's moving along down the road. When you're building a tiny house, you should really put it together using screws for everything. Think about this. Every time you drive a trailer down the highway, you are subjecting that structure to 60 mile per hour winds. Anytime you hit bumps in the road, you are subjecting the home to 5.0 earthquakes. That means anytime you move your trailer, you are literally putting your house through hurricanes and earthquakes. That is a massive amount of stress to place on the structure. You can't use nails to hold it together. My entire place was built using screws. Now, this might seem like a minor thing, but again, after months and years of moving down roads, screws make a huge difference. My original design ideas for the tiny house were to build it out of a shipping container. But unfortunately, there were no RVIA certified builders who were willing to help me do that. Everybody who is actually a certified builder refused to make it out of a shipping container because they had never done that and they didn't really know how to do it. So unfortunately, I couldn't go that route. Instead, I used metal siding, which still kind of gives it that shipping container look and feel, which I really liked because I like that kind of industrial spaceship kind of look. But I also wanted kind of the rustic cabin, so I did both. On the porch area, it's all wood, so that if I'm out on the porch, you know, it feels like I'm in this cool, like, wood cabin. And then the rest of it is more metallic, so it does look less like a tiny house and more like an RV. So if I take it to RV parks and things like that, it kind of fits and it blends in well. I used metal because I liked the aesthetic of something industrial and kind of like the Apollo space program. You know, I know my tiny house is not pretty or quaint. This isn't a tiny house that looks like some adorable cottage out of a fairy tale. You know, this looks more like a shipping container. And I love that. I wanted something sleek and modern. You know, this is not a girly tiny house. You know, all the ones you see on television with the cute little hippie chicks with a nose ring and they, you know, live in their tiny house? No, that's not me at all. This is a house for a dude.
The windows on the house are really nothing all that special. They're standard double-paned glass windows that you would have in any kind of regular house.
For some reason, many people like to put tons of windows in tiny houses, but this is a terrible idea for multiple reasons. First of all, security, right? Every window is just another place someone can break into your house. Number two, storage space. Every window you install eliminates wall space, which can no longer be used for cabinets or shelving or storage. And third, unnecessary light. You know, people mistakenly presume that a lot of windows translates into a lot of light. But the truth is, sunlight is incredibly bright. You can easily light your entire home with beautiful, natural light by planning the location of your windows carefully. You don't need a large quantity of windows in order to have a lot of light. And despite being 38 feet long, my tiny house only has 5 windows. And honestly, that is one too many. I should have used 4 and only had 1 in the bedroom. And the bathroom window, that one should have been much smaller too.
Right from the beginning, when I first started coming up with this idea and designing my house, I knew right away that I still wanted to keep my motorcycle. So I needed to figure out a way to bring the motorcycle along and have it be a part of the house. And how could I build kind of a toy hauler version of a tiny house? And the way that the motorcycle actually physically attaches to the porch section is using the Pitbull trailer restraint system.
Two great advantages about this system are that it attaches onto the rear axle of the motorcycle and does not require a front wheel chock. Plus, it doesn't require straps, thereby allowing full travel in the suspension system of the motorcycle and preventing bumps in the road from blowing out the seals on the shock absorbers.
I do not remember the exact television show that I was watching when I was a little kid and I first heard about solar panels. The show might have been National Geographic or Omni, something like that, some kind of science program, you know, 3-2-1 Contact was a little kid's science show. But whatever show that was, I do vividly remember my reaction to seeing solar panels. I mean, I was blown away. I thought this was the most magical piece of technology that I had ever seen, right? This black plate of glass that creates electricity from sunlight. Like, how is that possible? You know, as a little kid who was very into science and technology, I had some pretty basic understandings of science and technology, and it seemed to me that light and electricity have nothing to do with each other, right? I mean, magnetism and electricity, those are related, but sunlight? How can this be? I just thought this was the coolest thing ever. And I remember from the moment I saw that, I thought, that's what I want. You know, when I'm a grown-up someday, I want to have a house that runs on solar energy, that's just purely powered by sunlight. Because that is really, really cool.
The solar panels are one Soltec PV module 1STH250WH panels. A single panel puts out 250 watts, 30.7 volts, and 8.15 amps. Now, there are a total of 6 panels in my system.
One of the most common questions that people ask when you're thinking about doing a tiny house project is, well, why don't you just get an RV, right? I mean, it seems like it's kind of the same thing, and the RV is already made, it's all put together. Well, there are two big disadvantages to an RV. The first, most obvious one is the fact that you can't customize it like you can a tiny house, right? Tiny house, you build whatever your imagination comes up with. You can make it really personal and really yours. The other thing that a lot of people don't think about is insulation. Most RVs are not insulated very well. Even the more expensive high-end ones aren't, because RVs are really designed to be used for just a couple of weeks out of the year and usually in a pleasant kind of climate, right? It's something that you take on family vacation in the summer. So the insulation isn't really designed to hold up to harsh winters or to really, really intense heat from summer days. You know, they're really built to be lived in for a couple of weeks when it's 75 degrees, right? So with the tiny house, you can insulate it like a regular home.
My original intent was to use an integrated insulation technology like metal-infused structurally engineered panels, or SIPs, from a company like Raycor. Now, this would provide an extremely well-insulated, rigid, and lightweight option for building materials. Unfortunately, they're also rather expensive, and my builder claimed that he couldn't afford to use those at my price point. So instead, we went with regular closed-cell foam in between the standard wood joists.
Now we can move on to the more interior systems of the tiny house, starting with the electrical system. So right from the beginning, I knew that I wanted to have a structure that was 100% solar powered, right? No gas, no propane, nothing like that, just pure electricity and solar energy. Now, I knew that this was possible, but most people told me, oh, that can't be done. You know, you still need to use propane to heat your water or this or that. And I was like, no, it can be done with solar. I'm confident that it can. So that's the way I want the system to be designed. So I am still learning a lot about the way solar works and all the things about electricity that go into it. So I'm not going to give a ton of detail because, quite frankly, I think if I tried, I'd probably say some things that were incorrect. So I'm just going to go over the basics so that you kind of understand how a basic solar and electrical system works, because that much I do understand at this point. And besides that, you know, there are so many variables, there are so many factors that you could easily create a whole series of videos on that topic alone. And since that's not the intention of this video, I just want to keep it simple. So for those of you who don't know, the way that solar works is it's a lot more complicated and it's a lot more simple than most people tend to explain. So let's start with the simple. You only need four things. You only need four pieces of equipment to have a solar-powered system. You need, obviously, the solar panels, you need batteries, you need a charge controller, and you need an inverter. Now, there are some charge controllers and inverters that are actually integrated into one unit. So, in that case, you would only need three pieces of equipment.
I have a bank of eight DMC-0100 interstate batteries. They are 12-volt AGM batteries rated at 100 amp hours. So that gives me about 12,000 watt hours per battery, or 1.2 kilowatt hours. So I have two banks connected in series parallel. So that is one bank of four batteries connected together in series. Then I have a second bank of four batteries connected in series. Those two banks are then connected to each other in parallel to create a 24-volt system. And that gives me a total of 9,600 watt hours or 9.6 kilowatt hours. My charge controller is an EP Solar Tracer 3215RN. My inverter is a Microsolar 24 volt 3000 watt peak 6000 watt pure sine wave inverter. And another important facet of a tiny house being built on a trailer is that it allows your electrical system to be truly grounded to the earth. As long as your ground wires are attached to metal on the trailer, you are assured of a reliable ground.
Ah, water. Water is everything, isn't it? Another very, very common question that you get when you're working on a project that's out in the desert where there's no water. I'm sure everybody out there knows about the rule of three, right? That you can only survive for a certain period of time without certain essential things. You can survive for approximately 3 minutes without air. You can survive for approximately 3 hours without shelter. In other words, say if it's really cold, you know, right, you get hypothermia. When it's winter time and it's way below zero, you could only survive for 3 hours before you freeze to death. You can only survive for 3 days without water. And you can survive for 3 weeks without food. So, water is essential to life. That's not news to any of you. All of you know that. But how do you get water? Well, this section I will go over the different options that you have to acquire water, how you get it into the tiny house, how you store it, and of course, how you get it back out again through the faucets and the water tap and the shower and all that sort of thing. So we'll start out with, how do you get water? Well, there are a lot of different options. You could drill for a well. That's one option. You could haul water in, or you can pay companies that have big trucks of water and you can haul that in and put it into a water tank. There are things called atmospheric water generators. You could buy one of those, which pulls water vapor from the air, condenses it, turns that into drinkable water. You could also use a device called a fog catcher, which is basically a big net that kind of gets, again, moisture from the air and pulls. Now, of course, fog catchers and atmospheric water generators don't necessarily work all that great in an environment such as the desert. You could also purchase your own water trailer, which is similar to water hauling and having a truck come along, but then you would have your own trailer with a tank on it and you could go out and pick up water and bring it back. Another option is you could use an inflatable water bladder such as an Aqua Tank 2. And they come in different sizes. They have 100, 150, 200 gallons. You can use one of those and take it to wherever you could get water, a campground or an RV park that, you know, would say, yeah, that's cool. You know, we don't mind you, you know, pay the day fee and you can fill up your water tanks. So there are a lot of different options for how you can acquire water.
Let's say you're using something such as an Aqua Tank 2 to acquire water. Well, how do you get the water back out of the Aqua Tank again? Well, if you can get your tank higher than the input valve on your tiny house, you can simply use gravity. But if that is not possible, you have to use a pump. I use a Drummond 1/10 horsepower transfer pump from Harbor Freight. Now, there are a lot of pumps on the market which are similar to this one, and they're just sold under different brand names. Now, this pump can drain a 150-gallon tank in about 1 hour, and it only draws 2 amps of power. So when I use it on a bright, sunny day, it runs 100% off my solar panels and draws no current at all from my battery bank. where do you actually keep all the water? Well, my tiny house stores more water than any other tiny house I have ever seen. I have 400 gallons of fresh water and 100 gallons of gray water. And there's no need to store black water since I have a composting toilet. Yes, you heard me correctly. I have 500 gallons in total. And that is around 2 tons of water if all the tanks were filled. I have 3 water tanks. 2 are tied together for fresh water, and 1 is used for gray water. So now that we know where the water comes from and how it is stored, the next question is, okay, how does it get back out again? Well, I use a standard RV water pump. My system uses a SureFlow 4048 high flow pump, which pumps water at 4 gallons per minute and runs on 4 to 10 amps depending upon the amount of water being used. That means it could draw maximum power and run for 4 hours straight and only drain 1 battery in my system. So that's pretty great because it's very, very low power usage.
How do you actually move the water around inside the tiny house, right? What about the plumbing and the pipes themselves? Well, in a traditional house, you would tend to use galvanized pipes or copper pipes or maybe even PVC piping. Now, none of those options are very good to use in a tiny house. Most RVs use what is called PEX piping. Now, this is a flexible polyethylene drinking water safe pipe that, like I said, it's flexible. So the thing that's cool about that is as the trailer is moving and rocking around as you're going down the road, you don't have to worry about pipes breaking or seals developing cracks in them and getting leaks all over the place. So PEX piping is definitely the way to go when you are requiring a plumbing system in a structure that's going to have a lot of movement within it.
Another reason that PEX piping is very common to use in recreational vehicles is because it has the ability to expand and contract. And since an RV can be subjected to so many temperature extremes, PEX is an ideal choice to stand up against potential freezing and cracking and breaking under those kind of conditions.
So now that you know how the water gets in and you know how the water kind of moves around, how do you know when you need to get more water? Well, the tanks that I have happen to be translucent, so you can just look at them and you kind of get an idea of how much water you have. But you can also use a great piece of equipment and technology called a sea level 2, which is basically an electronic meter that tapes to the side of the tank, and it will give you a reading in percentages of how much water is left in your water tanks. In the summertime, it gets so freaking hot in the desert that you don't really need a water heater. When it's 105 degrees and the water is 80 degrees, man, that's great. You know, you're happy to take a nice cool shower. But in the winter, it's a different story. If the inside of the tiny house gets down to 50 degrees and that water is 40 degrees, well, let's just say that when you brace yourself for that shower, that's when you think, yeah, this is why I'm single. No woman could endure this. So having a water heater definitely helps reduce the sting a bit. And the way that we set up the water heater, in my opinion, is pretty cool. We came up with a great idea because it uses so much energy, and there was no way to have it running all the time when it's purely solar powered. So all we did was set it up on its own circuit. So when I need heated water, I flick a light switch, the water heater turns on, and within 20 to 30 minutes, it will fully heat up that 6 gallons of water to a nice warm temperature. I flick the switch off, can take a shower, and not have certain parts of my anatomy shrivel up into my throat.
The exact make and model of the water heater is a Whirlpool Electric 6-gallon water heater. It is the E1F6 US017V. And this thing, as I said, uses a massive amount of energy. It draws about 1,650 watts or 14 amps on an AC current. So converted to DC for the battery system, that is a massive 77 amps, which means in a mere 30 minutes, I drain 2 full batteries. So that is why I can't have the water heater on all the time. There's simply not enough power to run something of that magnitude. Consequently, the electrical outlet has been wired to a light switch.
People frequently ask, how is it that I get internet in such a remote location? Well, I actually have 2 systems, mainly for redundancy and safety, right? So if one system goes down, the other one will hopefully still be working. If the zombie apocalypse comes and the zombies take down one cell tower, I can still use the other phone. So the way that it works when you're out in a remote location is, look, as long as you have a little bit of a signal, the best thing you can do is to get an internet booster. I happen to have one from WeBoost. And the thing that's really great about the WeBoost boosters is that they actually amplify both signals. They amplify the cell phone signal itself, and they will also amplify the internet signal. In this case, it's for 4G internet. So it amplifies the 4G signal and the telephone signal independently of one another. Now, some systems out there only amplify one or the other. The great thing about WeBoost is that it does both.
Technology is obviously changing and improving constantly, but at the time this video was created, there were really 2 ways to get onto the internet if you were off the grid. One is through satellite, and the other one is through a 4G hotspot. Now, I use a Drive 4GX OTR from WeBoost to increase the 4G signal for my ZTE Falcon Z917 hotspot. Now, with the booster on, I get around negative 80 decibels as my signal, and ordinarily that would still be kind of weak. However, because there is so little traffic on the cell towers when you're off the grid, I still manage to get very high connection speeds, averaging over 10 megabits per second. And the WeBoost, as I mentioned before, also improves the CDMA signal for the Verizon cell phone.
In other videos I've made, people have noticed the fact that I have a landline telephone. And of course, people are very curious about that because they're like, wait a second, he's off grid out in the middle of the desert. There's no phone lines going out to him. So how can he have a regular landline phone? Like, is that just a prop? Is that just a nostalgic thing? Well, no, it is actually a fully functional telephone. How do I do it? I use a really cool piece of technology called the X-Link Cellular Bluetooth Gateway, which is an incredibly simple little device. All it is a little unit that plugs into an electrical outlet, and it has a phone jack in it. You take your landline phone, you plug it into that, and then through Bluetooth, it will synchronize with your cell phone. And from there, you can use that landline phone just like a regular telephone. When somebody calls your cell phone number, the landline phone will ring, and you could pick it up and answer it and talk through it like a normal telephone call. You can also pick the phone up and you'll have a dial tone, and you can use it like a regular phone. It sends the signal through the X-Link device that goes to your cell phone, and the cell phone makes the call. Now, the reason that I wanted to do this is because I really, really hate cell phones. I mean, cell phones are one of those pieces of technology that has never, ever sounded better than traditional old analog phones, right? When you're talking to somebody on a cell phone, it's terrible. The sound quality is awful. You can hardly ever hear the person. They can never hear you. And I don't care how new the phone is. I don't care how expensive it is. Nothing beats holding that handset and having a big mouthpiece and a big earpiece so you can easily hear the person and they can easily hear you. That's why I wanted to stick with a traditional landline phone, because they just work better. The internet providers that I use are Verizon for telephone and voice calls and T-Mobile for an internet connection. Now, the reason that I did that was because I knew that Verizon has some of the best coverage for making phone calls. And T-Mobile had one of the best plans that I could get at that time. They were offering a plan that had a really, really high data cap. Plus, using certain streaming services on the internet did not count against that data. And as a person who does a lot of productions for YouTube videos and things like that, that was a really great opportunity for me, because uploading videos and watching videos didn't count against my data limit. Coming up with a great bed was very important. I know that might sound like kind of a silly thing, like, why, what difference? Just get a bed. But here's the thing. You know, as human beings, we spend an extraordinary amount of time asleep, right? A good third of our lives. So the bed should be comfortable. But it was more than that. It was the simple fact that I knew that this was going to be a monumentally life-changing experience. And therefore, when it came time to just lay down, relax, go to sleep, it has to be incredibly comfortable, right? You want that moment when you're alone with your thoughts to be a place where you can genuinely relax. And I really lucked out with all of the sort of pieces of technology that I ended up using to put the bed together.
I knew if the bed was not comfortable, I would go running back to a nice two-bedroom townhouse again. So the mattress that I got is from a company called Attable, and it is a foam mattress. And the thing that's really great about an Attable foam mattress is that it really holds in your body heat, which is fantastic for those chilly winter evenings. The next thing are the modal sheets. Now, modal is a very interesting fabric that I had never heard of before. It is a cotton that is extremely soft. It feels like a very worn-out t-shirt, and it's really comfortable. Next, I have an original microfleece blanket from berkshireblanket.com, and that is another layer that I end up using on those really cold nights. And then finally, a polyester down comforter. So basically, it's the mattress and three layers of sheets. And I have experienced evenings that were as cold as 45 degrees, and the temperature underneath the blankets was still 85, even though the tiny house was 45 degrees. So this works really well, this combination of a mere three layers with an Attable twin mattress. Now, many people claim that beds can sweat and condensation can form under them, which renders the mattress all moldy and unhealthy. Now, this has not been my experience, although I do have a plastic protective cover encasing the entire mattress, and I am in a very dry climate. So those two factors might be why I have never experienced such problems. I have checked under the bed periodically and never found any signs of mold or moisture or funky smells or anything.
Sometimes you might use a piece of technology that seems a little bit frivolous, but it actually serves some really important purposes. One of those things is my lacrosse technology weather station. Now this thing is really cool because it actually monitors wind speed, temperature, humidity. It even gives a forecast of upcoming weather. Now why is this essential and important? Well, out in the desert, you often get some extremely windy days. And it can be very disconcerting when your trailer is getting pushed around in those kind of winds. But keep in mind, RVs and tiny houses are designed to be moving down the highway at 60 miles an hour. So you have a continual 60 mile an hour wind pushing on the structure for hours and hours at a time. Therefore, you shouldn't get too worried if you happen to have a 25, 30, even 40 mile an hour wind hitting the side of your trailer, because it's designed to endure things that are a lot more severe than that. Nevertheless, as I said, that can be a very disconcerting kind of thing. So it's nice to be able to monitor wind speeds and understand, well, at what kind of speed does this thing really start to move around? If you know, hey, at 25 miles per hour, it can actually shake pretty hard. Well, it's reassuring to know that it's only 25, right? Because now, as scary as it might feel to have the thing moving around like that, you know, gosh, it's only a 25 mile an hour wind, so I don't have to worry about anything getting damaged. Another thing that's really useful, just in terms of comfort, is being able to monitor outside temperatures in different places of the tiny house. For example, knowing what the temperature is outside, that's pretty obvious, but you also want to know, well, what's the temperature, say, where your water tanks are at, to make sure your water tanks aren't freezing in the winter, or if you have your water heater in a place that's maybe not insulated as well as the rest of the house, you want to make sure that's not going to freeze. It's nice to be able to monitor what temperature it is in the area where that heater is at. Another thing that's really useful is, let's say, for example, in the summertime, all right, you have really nice, pleasant, cool evenings, but it's very hot during the day. So in the evening, you might open up all your windows, right? Let the nice cool breeze come through. The place cools down nicely at night. But when the sun comes up and it starts to heat up, when should you close your windows? All right, obviously, once it starts getting too warm outside compared to the inside, that's the best time to close them. So if it's gone down to 70 degrees, you can monitor the temperature and say, oh, okay, it hit 71 degrees outside, the temperature is still climbing, I should close the windows now so I can keep that nice 70 degree air inside. And then same thing happens in the evening, right? The house is gonna heat up, and when it starts to cool down at night, you can monitor the temperature and say, oh, okay, now it's actually cooler outside than it is inside, so I can open the windows back up, right? So it's not a frivolous thing to have a weather station. It's actually incredibly useful.
The make and model of my weather station is a Lacrosse Technology 327-1417 Professional Color Wind Speed Weather Station. Now, this weather station has one wind sensor, and it has three temperature sensors. So I use those throughout various parts of the tiny house. I have one mounted outside, so I know what the exterior temperature is. I also have one mounted by my water tanks, so I know what the temperature is there. And finally, I have one mounted out by the water heater, so I know what the temperature is on the pipes that are leading to and from the water heater unit.
The bathroom actually doesn't have anything all that special when it comes to technology. The bathroom sink, the bathtub, they all are standard household items, standard fixtures, standard plumbing. But One thing that is a little bit different and is kind of a cool technology is the Nature's Head composting toilet. Nature's Head is probably the most commonplace composting toilet on the market. It's a really great one to get because there's a lot of information on it and it's very, very well constructed.
There are a lot of options for composting toilets, but the Nature's Head is kind of the industry standard. Nature's Head is durable, sanitary, easy to clean, uses minimal power, and can last about 3 months before needing to be emptied. And I personally use coconut husk as the compost material, and a quarter block is enough to fill the chamber. So, a single brick of coconut husk can supply the toilet for an entire year.
One of the coolest pieces of technology in the kitchen is the induction cooktop. Now, the reason that I am really fascinated by things like induction cooktops is because they're a relatively new technology. I mean, they've probably only been around for maybe 15, 20 years. But theoretically, we could have had them for even longer than that, right? Because the technology that they use is really nothing all that special. It's something that we could have developed a long time ago, but nobody ever thought of it. And that kind of thing is always really cool to me. So for those of you who don't know, the way that an induction cooktop works is, I'm sure many of you are aware that electricity and magnetism are the same thing, right? If you take a coil of wire and you run a current through it, it generates a magnetic field. And the opposite is true as well. If you take a wire and you move a magnet back and forth across that wire, it generates an electrical current. That's one of those kind of science things that I think is awesome because, you know, to this day, we don't really know why that happens, right? Scientifically speaking, we can prove that it does happen, but we really don't know why. That's kind of cool. So an induction cooktop basically uses some of those kind of principles. Inside of the cooktop, you have a coiled wire, and you send an oscillating electrical current through that wire. That creates a magnetic field, and that magnetic field creates eddy currents inside of any kind of ferromagnetic material, such as iron. Those eddy currents, because of the resistance within the material, they start to heat up that object. And as that object heats up, that's how you're able to cook whatever food is in that thing, whether it's stainless steel or iron or, as I said, any other ferromagnetic material. So it's a really neat technology. It's cool because it's a relatively new technology. And it's fascinating to me because we could have had that back in the 1940s, but nobody ever thought of it.
The induction cooktop I use is a Duxtop 9300 ST 1500 watt ultra thin unit. And I use a large 10.5 inch cast iron skillet, which fits perfectly on top of the cooktop. Now I had a 12 inch skillet, and that one was a little too large, so I just gave it to a friend of mine. The 10.5 inch diameter skillet fits over the coil element exactly right, so the surface heats evenly all around. And that's one thing that's really important to remember if you're using an induction cooktop, is that whatever your cookware is should fit exactly inside, because if it doesn't, if it's a little too big, then the outer edge of that cooktop is never going to get heated, and you're not going to be able to cook food very well because it's going to be kind of weird. The edges of the skillet are going to stay cold, and if it fits exactly right, it'll work perfectly.
So are you watching this video because you might be thinking about building a tiny house yourself? Okay, let me save you some trouble, right? Right now I'm about to save you a lot of research. Buy an angle for your fridge and freezer. Period, end of story, don't bother to do any more research, okay? Angles are, hands down, the best. Why are they the best? Two reasons. Number one, they're incredibly reliable. And number two, they use very, very little power. And if you have an off-grid kind of setup, that's what you're always looking for everything when it comes to power usage, stuff that has minimal draws. And in that way, angles cannot be beat. So, for those of you who live here in the good old US of A, you've probably never heard of angle. For those of you who might be living in Australia, you probably have heard of angle. Angle is not really well known outside of Australia. They were invented in Australia, and the compressor motor that is used inside of angle fridges and freezers was actually engineered in Germany, and it is built in Japan, and it is called the Sawafuji swing motor. The thing that makes this thing so incredible is that it only has one moving part, and that's part of the reason why they're so reliable. Angle has been around for 40 years, and there are angle fridges from 30, 40 years ago that are still working and still running. Every other portable kind of fridge out there, they all use the same compressor, okay? So whether you're looking at other brands like Dometic or Winter or
ARB, that's another very popular fridge,
all of those fridges use this compressor called a Danfoss. And there's nothing wrong with it, but you're actually not buying a different product, right? Because the compressor, of course, is the heart of your fridge or freezer. So all of these other companies are basically using the exact same thing. The only thing that's different is the controls on it and the insulation and things like that. Otherwise, there's really no difference between all these other products. The angle is the only one that uses the Sawafuji swing motor. That's part of the reason that it's so reliable, and that's part of the reason that makes it so different from all the other ones out there.
The fridge is an angle MT60F-UI, and I did a lot of research on the fridge and freezer. Since I knew I would have to run a fridge and freezer 24 hours a day, on nothing but solar power, I had to make sure they were very efficient and drew as little power as possible. These appliances would be the largest continuous power draw of anything in the house. I mean, yes, things like the heater and air conditioner would draw more energy in a short period of time, but the fridge runs 24 hours a day. Nothing else runs 24 hours a day except for the fan on the composting toilet, and that is a negligible power draw. Now this fridge pulls about 1.2 amps at 144 watts, so that works out to about 6.62 amps DC 24 volts from an inverter. So over the course of 8 hours, that only drains one of my batteries at 116 amp hours. And keep in mind that math would only be accurate if it was running for 8 hours continuously. Now, since the fridge turns off almost 50% of the time, the power draw is far less than what I am calculating. The refrigerator easily maintains an internal temperature of 40 degrees even when the temperature inside the house exceeds 90 degrees. The freezer is an angle MT35F-U1. Now the freezer pulls about 0.71 amps at 85 watts, so that works out to 3.92 amps DC 24 volts from the inverter. Now that means over a period of 8 hours, it drains less than one battery to 50% capacity. So my fridge and freezer together use less energy than two batteries when running all night. Now that's pretty amazing. And my freezer maintains a temperature of 0 degrees even when it is 90 degrees inside my tiny house.
The water that I use is extremely clean because not only am I getting potable water, but I'm actually running it through two charcoal filters before it even gets into the tiny house. As a result, I probably don't really need to do any other sort of filtering, but I still really love the water distiller that I have. I've been using it since I had an apartment in North Hollywood, and it is a fantastic, fantastic machine. It is built by a company called Pure Water, and it is made right here in the good old US of A, and they give you a 15-year warranty. How many other products can you buy that has a 15-year warranty? To me, that is a sign of good old American engineering. They really stand behind their product. Now, I don't think that, you know, there's a big conspiracy to poison us with fluoride and stuff like that. But I do believe in that precept, Hanlon's razor, right? Never attribute to malice that which can be explained by stupidity. So while I don't think that our tap water is poisoning us through any sense of malice, it could be through pure stupidity and bureaucratic ineptitude. So I think it's probably a good idea to do that extra bit of filtering before you go drinking that water. And that's why I like using a water distiller.
The exact make and model of the water distiller is the Mini Classic CT by Pure Water. Now, this thing does draw a massive amount of energy. It runs about 800 watts, and the thing is on for about 3 hours in order to produce 1 gallon of water. So I can pretty much only use this when it is summertime and I have a lot of power coming off of the solar panels and recharging the batteries. Doesn't really work too well in the winter. If I try to do it in December, January, it draws way too much energy. But during summer months, it runs just fine.
Obviously, in a space as small as I have, there's no way that I could use a traditional oven. And honestly, I don't really need one. I mean, I don't bake a whole lot of stuff. I don't make big meals for a large family, so it's not like I'm putting in a whole turkey. But I really don't like microwave ovens. I just think that they make food taste funky, and I've never really liked the quality of the food that comes out. So, what other options do I have? Can't have a microwave because they're gross. Can't have a traditional oven because they're too big. So I went with the best toaster oven that I could find. This one happens to be from Breville. And the Breville toaster oven is big enough that I can put, you know, like a nice medium-sized pizza in there. Yet I get to use good old-fashioned heat instead of microwave technology to heat up the food.
The Breville Smart Oven Pro with Element IQ does pull a lot of power, about 1800 watts at 120 volts, so that is about 15 amps. Now converted to 24 volt DC, that is around 82 amps. So it consumes about 2 batteries worth of energy to run for 1 hour. Now that is a huge energy draw. And remember, I only have 8 batteries, and I use about 2 of them to run my fridge and freezer all night. And another 2 anytime I cook dinner in the toaster oven. So that leaves me with 4 batteries for the rest of the evening, which is plenty if I don't have to run a heater. So as a result, I try to only use my toaster oven during the day when I can recharge the batteries with plenty of sunlight. But I do occasionally run it after sunset, and I've never had any problems with it.
When you're living in an environment like the desert, One of the most common questions you get from people is, gosh, doesn't it get hot? You know, how do you deal with the heat? Well, dealing with the heat is actually pretty easy. It's dealing with the cold. That's what can be a challenge. I use a mini split, which is something that a lot of tiny houses use. Mini splits are great because they're designed to both heat and cool relatively small spaces, usually a single room. So they're perfect for tiny house construction. So, in the summertime, it's actually pretty easy to keep cool. Having white metal siding that really reflects off a lot of light and cools the place down, the insulation helps a great deal. Plus, during the day, I have a ton of sunlight, so I can actually run my mini split as an air conditioner for hours at a time. Then, in the evening, when it starts to cool off, I can turn it off, open up the windows, and have a nice 70 degree breeze blowing through the house. The winter, on the other hand, that's a different story. The coldest part of the day is obviously the night, right? The middle of the night is when it gets the coldest. And the middle of the night is when you have to run everything off of battery power. You can't run it off the solar panels. In winter, the cold reduces your battery capacity. In winter, the sun is much lower on the horizon, so it doesn't hit the solar panels, it doesn't charge the batteries as well. And finally, you don't get as much sunlight during the winter. Your days are a lot shorter. So all of those factors together make it extremely difficult to run something like a mini split in the evening. You can really only do it based on the system that I have for maybe an hour or so, which is definitely not enough time when it's going down to 20 degrees outside. So that is one big drawback. And some people have suggested doing things like, well, why don't you get, you know, a wood stove or something like that? Well, the thing is, they're extraordinarily expensive. I'm talking like $5,000, right? Whereas my battery bank, that costs about $1,500. So I'm like, well, for the same price, I could triple my battery bank, and then I could probably just run the mini split, right? So a lot of factors to think about, a lot of factors to weigh, but overall, a mini split works really great. And as long as it's not brutally cold, it can still heat up the place pretty well.
The mini-split system in my house is a 9,000 BTU Pioneer WYS 009 AMF I17RL. That is one heck of a model number. Now, I find that it runs really well because my tiny house is very well insulated, and it tends to maintain a 20 degree temperature difference between the interior and the exterior. So when it is 100 degrees outside, I can maintain 80 degrees inside. And when it drops to 40 degrees outside, I can hold at 60 degrees inside. Now, based on the power it needs, I can theoretically run the mini split for approximately 1 hour for every two of my batteries. So if my eight batteries are fully charged and I use two of them overnight for my fridge and freezer, I can still run the heater for 3 hours. In reality, the run times are much shorter than that, but in theory, that is what they should be.
Well, there you have it, folks. So as you can see, I definitely do not fit any of the stereotypes of typical tiny house owners, right? I mean, I'm definitely not some vegan tree-hugging hippie, and I'm also not some paranoid conspiracy theorist doomsday prepper. I'm more of a joyful geek who just loves science and technology, who admires people like Nikola Tesla and Walt Disney. And that is the inspiration for things like this in my life. You know, I really believe that technology can be our salvation and not our ruin. So, to claim that this is the world's most advanced tiny house, that's a pretty big boast, but I don't think anybody can prove that wrong, because in all the years of research that I did to put this project together, I can say that I have never seen anyone else create anything like this. Nobody else has made a self-contained unit that you could theoretically probably live in for about 6 months completely off-grid. As long as you like really conserved your water, I bet you could push it to about 6 months. Nobody else has ever done that. And that's something that I'm incredibly proud of, because despite the fact that I am not an engineer or an architect, absolutely everything that I planned, everything that I came up with, all of it worked, right? Nothing failed. All these ideas that I had came together and everything functions as I expected. I mean, yeah, of course, there's always little things here and there that you might want to tweak and improve, but overall, I did something that functioned, even though a lot of people doubted that it could. I had so many potential contractors and tiny house builders that I approached with these ideas, and so many of them just turned me down and said, no, you can't do that, or that's not going to work. And they were wrong, and I was right. So don't forget that, man. You know, if you want to do something like this, or if you want to achieve any other kind of dreams in your life, don't listen to the naysayers. They are servants of the nothing. Do what you dream. And make sure that those dreams terrify you. Do something that you do think might fail. Do something that keeps you up at night worrying about it. You know why? Because if it doesn't, well, then it's too easy, right? I mean, anybody can be mediocre. Don't aspire to mediocrity. Aspire to do something that is beyond what you think you can even accomplish. Because if your ambitions don't scare you, they're not big enough.